Module, I'm going to discuss the treatment of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. In a patient who presents with a history and physical examination which is suggestive of interstitial lung disease, you have to exclude the known causes of interstitial lung disease. And then if you find a UIP pattern on HRCT or a certain combination of HRCT, if a person does not have a UIP pattern on HRCT, along with lung biopsy combination, you make a diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis with certainty. Historically, when the IPF progresses, the disease progression is insidious, at least initially. But it is said that data from the placebo arm of the clinical trial suggests that the fall in the FVC is about 150 to 200 ml per year in these patients. The course of the disease may be unpredictable, as some patients develop an acute deterioration after a period of apparent stability. Patients in the age group affected, majority are in the 6th or 7th decade. So these patients are prone to a lot of other diseases: breathlessness because of cardiac illness, because of weakness, aging process. So you have to keep those in account when you are making a diagnosis of IPF in these patients. So even in a patient who has been diagnosed in IPF, whether he's deteriorating because of the disease or because of these comorbidities, one has to always keep in mind. Now, coming on to the treatment, how to assess the severity, that's also very important. You have, because it will help you to put in a particular category and to follow them up. Which patient should be treated? When should therapy be started? What is the best therapy? And how should the disease course and the response to treatment be monitored? So these are the important questions which I'm going to answer in this talk. First is the assessing this disease severity. Stage the patient severity of disease, as this will help you to guide the treatment choices. A disease management plan is tailored to the disease severity and the desire of the individual patient, because the prognosis in this patient is not good. So you have to keep the patient preferences also when you make a plan for your patient. So what is a mild disease? Mild disease is patients are often asymptomatic or have a mild symptom, non-productive cough and dyspnea with substantial exertion. Radiographic changes of reticular opacities, areas of honeycombing are limited to subpleural and basilar area, involving less than 10% of the parenchyma. If you do a PFT, there may be mild reduction of the forced vital capacity and diffusing capacity, and a mild reduction in the walk distance of the 6-minute walk test. If you do an AO gradient, it is less than 20 millimeter of mercury. In the moderate disease, patient starts getting dyspnea on a moderate exertion. He has a non-productive cough and has a mild to moderate pulmonary function abnormality. What I mean to say is FVC 50 to 70%, DLCO 45 to 70% of the predicted. PO2 difference, in the mild it was less than 20, it is 21 to 30 in the moderate. And these patients may require supplemental oxygen when they make an exertion. Radiographic changes, now there are more than 10%, they may involve up to 20 to 30%. And one way of assessing how much is the HRCT involvement, it is said to quantify the radiographic changes, you should see the HRCT slice at the level of tracheal carina, inferior pulmonary vein, and 1 centimeter above the dome of the diaphragm. So these are the three places: carina, pulmonary veins, and 1 centimeter above the dome of diaphragm to quantitate the parenchymal changes. Advanced disease, these patients may be dyspneic even on rest or a mild exertion. They cannot walk even 300 feet. Requirement of supplemental oxygen at rest or on a mild exertion. They have extensive honeycombing on HRCT, more than 5%. PFT will reveal FVC less than 50% and DLCO less than 45% are predicted. They have oxygen saturation of more than 4% during a 6-minute walk test. Gas exchange is also impaired and the PO2 difference is more than 30. So if you see the mild patient had a very minimal symptoms, more or less normal pulmonary function test or a mild derangement of the diffusion capacity, a mild decrease in the forced vital capacity, less than 10% of the lung parenchyma is involved, and the AO2 difference, which is less than 20. If you go to moderate, the dyspnea increases, the FVC becomes 50 to 70% of the normal predicted, and the DLCO becomes less than 45. Then the involvement of the lung parenchyma increases, the AO2 difference is 21 to 30. If you go into severe, this can vary because some patient may be dyspnea even on rest and they can't walk even 300 feet. And they have extensive involvement of the lung with honeycombing, which is more than 5%. And the lung parenchyma is extensively involved in these individuals. They cannot walk without the oxygen assistant. And the PaO2 difference, the alveolar arterial oxygen difference, is more than 30 millimeter of mercury. You must assess the comorbidities for pulmonary hypertension, thromboembolic disease, COPD, heart failure, obstructive sleep apnea, and depression, because these diseases may be present in these individuals. So you should try to rule out that the symptoms are not because of these, they are because of the primary illness. How to monitor these patients? You have to monitor the dyspnea, exercise tolerance, FVC, total lung capacity, and the diffusion, oxygen at rest and with exercise by oximetry, and by doing a 6-minute walk test. So practically speaking, when you monitor symptoms, you monitor 6-minute walk test, and you can do a pulmonary function test if patient can do it. The treatment of IPF involves a medical therapy. Oxygen is a very important component of treatment of severe disease, lung transplant, and supportive care. Now coming on to the medical therapy, steroids have no role. N-acetylcysteine, no role. These are the two drugs. We have grown up using these drugs for the management of IPF, but they have absolutely now no role in the management of a proven case of IPF. Corticosteroid monotherapy, that although there are no randomized controlled trials, retrospective uncontrolled trials have shown that no survival benefit. Minority of patients may show some improvement in pulmonary functions, and recommendation is not to treat patients with steroids at present. N-acetylcysteine, all of us have used this drug either as a mucolytic agent in most of the cough syrups or an antidote for acetaminophen liver toxicity, or before the contrast study as a prevention for the renal failure. It's an antioxidant, glutathione precursor, and it was thought of it may have a role in patients of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. One of the important trial which has been published to find the efficacy of acetylcysteine is a PANTHER trial. In this, after screening, they had three arms: placebo, N-acetylcysteine, and the third arm included prednisolone, azathioprine, and N-acetylcysteine. All the three had more than 75 patients. The inclusion criteria included mild to moderate IPF, and the primary outcome they looked at was change in FVC at 60 weeks. And what they found was that there was no difference in the FVC at 52 weeks whether patient was taking placebo or N-acetylcysteine. So showing that it is not helpful in reducing the fall of FVC. And the other interesting thing they found, that the arm which had prednisolone, azathioprine, and N-acetylcysteine was harmful. And because of the increased mortality side effects, this study was terminated due to increased mortality in this arm. And they found there was increased mortality, increased hospitalization, and adverse events were more in patients who were being given prednisolone, azathioprine, and N-acetylcysteine. And 7 of the 8 deaths were due to respiratory causes. There was no difference in the change in FVC, diffusing capacity of carbon monoxide, or quality of life. So this study concluded that combination of high dose prednisolone N-acetylcysteine azathioprine had a higher rate of death, hospitalization and side effects than those of placebo. N-acetylcysteine, there's no difference in decline from placebo in patient with mild to moderate IPF, recommended against starting patients on N-acetylcysteine, also recommended against triple therapy, that is high dose prednisolone, N-acetylcysteine, azathioprine. And after this, even if patients who are on this, it is suggested that they should discontinue this therapy. The guidelines published by the ATS, ERS, GRS and ALT guidelines have been published in 2011 and they have been updated in 2015, and they have said very categorically that anticoagulation, combination of prednisolone, azathioprine, N-acetylcysteine, embrisantan, imatinib, which is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, they should not be used in patients of IPF. The drug which has recently changed the management of IPF, or which is now the drug of choice in treating patients of IPF, is the pirfenidone. These are the predominant pathological foci, as we know, is a fibroblast foci, collagen deposition, minimal cell infiltration, raising the possibility that probably if you use an antifibrotic agent, they may be helpful. So that was the reason the pirfenidone, which is an antifibrotic agent, that inhibits the transferrin growth factor beta stimulated collagen synthesis and blocks the fibroblast proliferation, could be a drug which could be useful in patients of IPF. So beneficial effect of pirfenidone is in the slowing the progression of IPF when administered to a patient with mild to moderate disease. And a possible mortality benefit has been shown in a pooled analysis. So let's see the trials which have come to this conclusion. First was the CAPACITY trial, phase 3 randomized double blind trial. They had two simultaneously running trial, PIPF-004 and PIPF-006. PIPF-004 included pirfenidone 1197 mg per day versus 2403 mg pirfenidone per day versus placebo. And the 006 trial had a pirfenidone high dose 2403 versus placebo. The patients chosen were again early IPF, and primary endpoint was percentage change in FVC at week 72. As you can see in this, what they found, there was the orange you see is a placebo, the fall of FVC is maximum in placebo. If you go higher dose 1197, the fall in FVC was decreased, and as you go higher to 2403, as you can see the blue, there was a further slowing of the fall of the FVC when you give a pirfenidone 2403 milligram per day. And the 006 trial also showed the same findings, but the interesting thing they found at 72 weeks, the benefit which was seen in the middle between 24 to 60 week was lost in these patients. But in middle, they did show the benefit of pirfenidone against the placebo. And when they combined this, they found that the benefit which was not seen in the 006 could be that these patients in the placebo arm had a more stable disease. So that's why this had reached at the same at 72 weeks. So conclusion from this study was the pirfenidone has a favorable benefit risk profile and represents the appropriate treatment option for patients with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. So seeing this and little doubt, then the another trial was planned, which is called the ASCEND trial. It's a phase 3 trial of pirfenidone in patients with IPF. It was published in 2014. The study design of the ASCEND trial was, they had a placebo arm with 278 patients and they had a pirfenidone arm with 277 patients. And they followed up these patients for 52 weeks. The primary outcome was percentage forced vital capacity change from baseline to week 52. And secondary outcome was change in the 6-minute walk test from baseline to week 52, progression-free survival, all-cause mortality. And they also saw the effect on the mortality by pooling the data from capacity and ascend. So the patients were randomly assigned to receive oral pirfenidone or placebo, and they followed these patients to 52 weeks. And what they found? They found the pirfenidone resulted in a significant reduction in the 1 year rate of decline in FVC. The proportion of patients in the pirfenidone group who had a decline of 10 percentage point or more in the percent of predicted FVC or died was reduced by 48% compared with placebo group. What I'm trying to say is that the patient who were receiving pirfenidone, the fall in FVC by 10% was 48% less as compared to the placebo group. Then nearly 23% of the pirfenidone group had no decline in the FVC at week compared to 10%. So here also you see that there is a benefit of pirfenidone as compared to the placebo, and which represents almost 133% increase in the proportion of patient with no evidence of FVC decline. And a secondary endpoint, they also saw it reduced the rate of decline in the 6-minute walk test and improved progression-free survival compared with the placebo, but did not reduce the dyspnea in these patients. When they combined the data of ASCEND and the CAPACITY trial, they found the pirfenidone was also responsible for decreasing the mortality from any cause in patient of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. The bottom line is that the pirfenidone slows the rate of progression of IPF. The fewer patient of taking pirfenidone died during the trials compared to those with placebo. Dosing 3 capsules taken 3 times per day with meals, and even higher dose have also been used by the clinicians. This, as far as the side effects are concerned, these patients have the GIT, nausea, vomiting. They may have a skin changes, and it is advised that regular blood work is required in these patients, and they should use a sunblock with SPF 50 when you're using a pirfenidone. Nintedanib, before discussing, I would like to say that growth factors often signal via tyrosine kinase. So it was the nintedanib is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor and acts on the tyrosine kinase receptors. So receptor which are for platelet-derived growth factor, vascular endothelium growth factor, and fibroblast growth factor. So by its action on these, it will inhibit the fibroblast migration, proliferation, and myofibroblast transformation. So this could be a drug which could be useful in patients of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. This is a drug which is used as a 150 milligram capsule twice daily along with meals. Now let's discuss the trials which have been published in favor of nintedanib. The important trial is the INPULSIS. The INPULSIS trial had a patient where they had screening of the patient, and then they had a placebo arm and the nintedanib arm, and they had a ratio of 3:2. The primary outcome they looked at was annual rate of decline of FVC, and the secondary outcome they looked at was the time to first acute exacerbation for IPF from baseline and change in the quality score. These trials were replicate, like there was INPULSIS 1 and INPULSIS 2, which were done simultaneously. Both were randomized double-blind phase 3 trials to evaluate the efficacy of 1 milligram twice daily of the nintedanib as compared to the placebo in patients with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. And as I said earlier, the primary endpoint was the annual rate of decline in FVC, vital capacity. As you can see in this, a total of 1,066 patients were randomly assigned to receive nintedanib or placebo. And what they found that in INPULSIS 1, the fall was FVC was 114.7 in the nintedanib arm and 239 with placebo. And INPULSIS 2, they find there was a fall of 113 with the nintedanib and 207 with placebo. So there was a difference in the fall in both the impulses 1 and impulses 2 when these patients were followed. And they found that there was a significant difference in the fall of FVC in the placebo arm and the nintedanib arm. In impulses 1, there was no difference in the time to first acute exacerbation, but impulses 2, they found there was significant difference or significant benefit with nintedanib to the time to first acute exacerbation was much more in patients who were being given nintedanib. The bottom line is nintedanib slows the rate of progression of IPF. Side effects can be managed by reducing the dose of nintedanib, and the side effects, the diarrhea is the most prominent, 62%. So if a person developed diarrhea, you ask him to take a lot of fluids and antidiarrheal medication like loperamide, reduction in the dose to 100 milligram daily, twice daily, reduction in the dose 100 milligram twice daily. If the low dose is not tolerated, then probably you stop, because at least 100 milligram twice daily should be stopped. And diarrhea has led to permanent dose reduction in 11% of patients and to discontinuation in 5% in the study which I enumerated little while ago. Nausea is seen about 24%, vomiting 12%, and the LFT rises in about 14%. So these are the side effects one should keep in mind, but diarrhea being the predominant side effects of nintedanib. The dose, as I said earlier, is a 150 milligram twice daily, approximately 12 hours apart with meals. LFT should be assessed prior to the initiation of nintedanib. Patient with moderate to severe impairment like child PUC B or C should not take nintedanib. So this is very important to do an LFT before starting this drug. After initiation, LFT should be repeated monthly for 3 months, and every 3 months thereafter or as clinically indicated. Dose modification or interruption may be necessary for renal enzyme elevation. A pregnancy test should be performed prior to the initiation of therapy in women of childbearing age, and conception should be avoided until at least 3 months after the last dose. This also interacts with the CYP3A4 and P glycoprotein and is an inducer and may also increase the risk of bleeding among patients on a full anticoagulation. So this also one has to keep in mind when you're using nintedanib. Up to 90% of patients with IPF have gastroesophageal reflux. It's an important risk factor for development and progression of IPF. The reflux in patient with IPF was associated with a hypotensive lower esophageal sphincter and abnormal esophageal paralysis, and often extending into the proximal esophagus. A retrospective study of 204 patients with IPF, they found that use of anti-GR medication was associated with decreased radiographic fibrosis score on chest computed tomography and was independent factor for longer survival time. An analysis of the data from the 3 randomized controlled trial and from the placebo arm, they found that patients who were taking PPI or H2 blocker had a smaller decrease in FVC at 30 weeks than those who were not taking the antacid treatment. So this could be modality which does decrease the progression of the IPF. So you require controlled trials to really recommend it as a modality routinely for patient of IPF. So the new guidelines suggest that clinician use regular antacid treatment for patient with IPF. It is a conditional recommendation, of course. Then sildenafil, these patients are prone to high pulmonary artery pressure, and particularly patient with more advanced IPF, a diffusing capacity who have less than 30% of predicted epocardial evidence of right ventricular dysfunction and high pulmonary artery pressure. There's a no contraindication to sildenafil. A trial of sildenafil may be a reasonable option. That is what we usually do. But the new guidelines say that clinicians should not use, because there is still not great evidence for use of sildenafil in the routine management of patients of severe IPF with the right ventricular dilatation and high pulmonary artery pressure. No medical therapy has been really been found to cure IPF, but two medications from my talk you must have guessed, perfenidone and nintedanib, appear to slow disease progression, and perfenidone, according to the study, have a mortality benefit. So patient with a mild to moderate IPF based on the pulmonary function test who do not have an underlying liver disease and who live in the area where perfenidone and nintedanib are available, the new guidelines published in 2015 suggest that we should be using one of these drugs to manage a patient of IPF. When to start, the decision of if or when to start therapy should be made after considering the effect of treatment and the side effect of the treatment. And it is very important discussion of the physician with the family about the side effects and everything to start a drug. So now the question comes, what to start? Should I start perfenidone or nintedanib? Not. There is no head-to-head trial to show that one is better than the other. Current data is insufficient to make a firm choice between perfenidone and nintedanib. If both are available, further study is needed to guide the choice. When choosing between the agent, patient preference and tolerance should be considered, particularly regarding the potential adverse effect, such as diarrhea and liver function test abnormality with the nintedanib versus the GI symptoms and a rash with the perfenidone. So it is important to discuss with the relatives, with the patient, that, and of course, the nintedanib at present is extremely expensive as compared to the perfenidone. Now, the other important aspect of management of IPF is the supportive care, which includes educating, symptoms management, oxygen, rehabilitation, vaccination, and palliative and advanced care. These should be offered to all patients of IPF. The patient should be educated about the diagnosis and management of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. It is important to discuss the natural history of disease and treatment options, the role of supplemental oxygen, and also, I think with the family, you need to discuss the end of life issues with advanced directives. Probably this may not be that relevant in a country like India where people don't want to discuss advanced directives, but I think important to discuss with the family. And you must try to understand the individual preferences, beliefs, and values. Pulmonary rehabilitation is as important in IPF as in COPD. Most of the data and support for the use of pulmonary rehabilitation has come from COPD patients. Several studies also support the use of pulmonary rehabilitation in interstitial lung disease. Then all these patients should be vaccinated. The pneumococcal vaccine and the influenza vaccine. Pneumococcal, as per the recommendation, you should give them, and influenza vaccine should be given every year to these patients. The supplemental oxygen therapy is also a very important modality to be used in patients of moderate to severe disease. And many patients who are dyspneic at rest and the oxygenation not able to maintain oxygenation, supplemental oxygen therapy should be used in these patients. Then palliative care is required in most of the advanced patients, and practically palliative care could be important in all stages and is not limited to the end of life care. See, palliative care, sometimes patient may require facial cooling with a fan, and many of these patients in many of these countries, they use small doses of opioids and anxiolytics in patients who have a refractory dyspnea and they are very discomfort. People have used this, but they should be used with a lot of caution. As you know, the opioids have a respiratory depressant effect. And now there are a lot of countries, and even in India, in the metro city, there is a concept of a home care which gives support to these kind of patient at home so that they do not require admission repeatedly in the hospital. And it is important that country like ours, we don't do many studies on the IPF. But I think it is important that you should encourage your patient to participate in clinical trials, as is done in many of the foreign countries. And that's how we have a data to use pirfenidone and nintedanib. So we should encourage, if there is not many side effects, discuss with the relatives and the patient to participate in the clinical trial. IPF is the most common ILD among referrals for lung transplant and second most frequent disease for which lung transplant is performed. And when to place these patients on the list? There are various recommendations by various institutes and the societies. When a person has a decline of FVC more than 10% during 6-month follow-up, decline in DLCO more than 15% during 6-month follow-up, when there's a desaturation of 88%, pulmonary hypertension on echo, and patient is getting admitted because of the pneumonia and exacerbation or respiratory failure, these patients should be placed on the lung transplant list. This is what is the recommendation in countries where the lung transplant program is very prevalent. This is starting in India, and probably we will know more and more about this in our country as well. What is the prognosis of IPF? 20 to 30% of the patients are alive after 5 years after the diagnosis. So very bad prognosis, this disease. And clinical deterioration is most frequently due to the disease progression. And as I said earlier, the fall in FVC is 150 to 200 ml per year in a patient of IPF. Hospitalization for respiratory problems are common events are frequently associated with death. And the other thing is, these patients ideally who are advanced disease should be counseled, should be advised not to go for a mechanical ventilation, because many times it just prolongs the inevitable. Patients of IPF, if they come to the ICU, there are greater risk of mortality than expected based on the severity of illness as assessed by the APACHE score. The several factor, they shorten the survival time. Older age at presentation, like patient is 75 years of old, extensive cigarette smoking, lower body mass index, more severe physiological derangement, greater radiological extent of disease, the development of other complications like pulmonary hypertension, emphysema, cardiovascular disease, or bronchogenic carcinoma. Bronchogenic carcinoma is only prevalent in a familial IPF. It is not seen that often in a normal IPF. So if these are present, they shorten because they are already, they are having the comorbid condition, they shorten the survival time of these patients. The complications of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, progressive respiratory failure, which is responsible for mortality in 39%, bronchogenic carcinoma, cardiovascular disease, which has a mortality of 24%, pulmonary infections, they can have a mortality of 2 to 4%, pneumothorax can develop in IPF, and pulmonary embolism. You know, the other thing is, a patient of IPF when become dyspneic, everybody thinks of infection. But pulmonary embolism, because these patients do not move much, they are prone to pulmonary embolism. So one should think this when you are dealing with such a patient. And of course, the complication of therapy. As I said, nintedanib is a drug which can have a liver function abnormality. So you need to monitor these when you are treating these patients. So in the last, I'm discussing about the acute exacerbation of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. An acute clinical significant respiratory deterioration characterized by evidence of new widespread alveolar abnormality, but does not set an exact 30-day limit for symptom onset and does not require exclusion of infection. So to say, when you want to make a diagnosis of acute exacerbation of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, person has a known diagnosis of IPF, there is acute worsening in less than 1 month, and the CT shows new bilateral ground glass opacification or consolidation superimposed on the background of his finding consistent with UIP or whatever you had found earlier. Heart failure or fluid overload does not explain the abnormality which you find on the CT. If these are present, you think it is an acute exacerbation of IPF. What is the incidence? 26.3 per 1,000 patients per year is the incidence of acute exacerbation. It is triggered post procedure, drug toxicity, infection, micro aspiration of gastric content. These are the things which can trigger acute exacerbation, and many a time there's idiopathic, no inciting agent identified. So typically these patients will present as a shortness of breath or worsening exercise tolerance that develops over days to week, but generally less than 1 month. Cough is common, fever and flu-like symptoms, and when you examine, the patients are tachypneic with a bibacillar crepitation consistent with the diagnosis of IPF. And they typically on the ABG will demonstrate impaired gas exchange and PF ratio less than 225 or a decrease of 10 millimeter from his usual gases. And the HRCT, as I said earlier, will show a new shadow, which could be a ground glassing or a consolidation on the background of a typical HRCT finding. So when you making a diagnosis of acute exacerbation, exclude alternate diagnosis like pneumothorax, heart failure, pulmonary embolism, as I said earlier. Identify potential trigger of IPF, lung infection or recent lung procedure. Many a times patients are subjected to bronchoscopy, they were doing all right and it triggers the acute exacerbation, and sometimes patient lands in a ICU and may have a disastrous consequences. So do a complete blood and differential count, do a pro-BNP to rule out heart failure, serial troponin test, procalcitonin, whether it's infective or not, it is a good to differentiate in these patients. If it is negative, probably you're not dealing with infection, it is a idiopathic or other exacerbation. Then blood culture should be sent. If it's a pneumonia, you send it for urinary antigen, for strep pneumonia and legionella if they're available. And rapid influenza test or test for respiratory pathogen, it is available in India and many which can give you the, and it's a PCR based test which can give you the kind of respiratory virus which has resulted in exacerbation. Imaging is done to exclude pneumothorax or other abnormality. And if you have a suspicion of pulmonary embolism, you do a HRCT with a pulmonary embolism protocol. And I said the findings would be over and above his usual IPF. You may find a consolidation or increase in the ground glassing. Bronchoscopy and lavage is a part of standard evaluation of a patient of acute exacerbation if patient can tolerate and you are suspecting an infection. The main role is to characterize the infection or if you are suspecting a malignancy. And the bowel sample should be done, should be sent for microbiological test, the bacterial, mycobacteria, fungi, as well as the PCR, because many of these patients might have received the steroids for a long time and they are prone to develop the PCP pneumonia. So this should be done, sent for everything. So the treatment is oxygenation, of course, may require some support, and steroids, prevention of venous thromboembolism, antacid therapy, mechanical ventilation, anti-infectives. So I shall discuss very briefly about them. Oxygenation is very important and often have a high oxygen requirement to maintain oxygen saturation above 88%, and you require high inspiratory flow rate. High flow oxygen therapy by nasal cannula, which is emerging, could be a reasonable option to use in these patients who do not have hypercapnia. The steroids, the international evidence-based guidelines for acute exacerbation, they suggest giving steroids. So steroids have a role in IPF during acute exacerbation, but no clinical trials have been performed, so it is more of an anecdotal recommendation. And when you want to give, you give a prednisolone 1 milligram per kg, or you can give a methyl prednisolone 1 gram per day for 3 days followed by tapering. And patients who have a response to steroids, and then they should be over a week or months, they should be tapered off. Then antibiotics, of course, you will use depending on the prevalent organism. You use a broad spectrum antibiotics. 7 to 10 days course is good enough. Procalcitonin, if you suspect it is non-infection, or for discontinuation of antibiotics, this could be a modality which can help you. Nintedanib and perfenidone do not start during acute exacerbation if patient is not taking earlier. Lung transplantation not during acute exacerbation. palliative care is very important to relieve symptoms of these patients. NIV, few suggested, have a role on non-invasive to reduce dyspnea. I think many of you may be using when a patient is terminal, you don't want to intubate, you can give non-invasive ventilation to these individuals to reduce the dyspnea. So to conclude, it's a disease which presents in the elderly population and has a bad prognosis. Corticosteroids, azathioprine, N-acetylcysteine, warfarin, ambrisentan, imatinib have no role in the management of IPF. For patient to mild to moderate IPF based on the pulmonary function and do not have an underlying liver disease, who live in the area where perphenidone and nintedanib are available, it is recommended to initiate therapy with the available agent. Current data are insufficient to choose one over the others. Further study is needed to guide the choice. Consider patient preferences and tolerance regarding potential adverse effect, diarrhea and liver function abnormality with nintedanib versus nausea, rash, stomach discomfort, photosensitivity and anorexia with perphenidone. The other thing is the nintedanib at present is extremely expensive as compared to perphenidone in India. Education, symptom management, supplemental oxygen, pulmonary rehabilitation, vaccination, palliative and advanced care should be offered to all patients of IPF. IPF is the most common ILD among referrals from lung transplant and second most frequent disease for which lung transplant is performed. 20 to 30% patients are alive 5 years after the diagnosis. And clinical deterioration is most frequently due to disease progression. Thank you.